I killed him. I killed him.
I did, silly. I did.
Hello, and welcome to Phantasmiac. I hope you're having a fantastic day, and if not, I hope I make your day a little bit better. Boy, what is your mind on? If you're new here, hi, I'm Voyia. I play a variety of games. If you ever want me to play something, please do not hesitate to ask. And with all that being said, let's get started. Oh, also don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, especially if you enjoy this video. Now let's begin. I have no idea what this is about. I did turn up the speed. I did not check anything else out. This place is bigger than I expected. For the price you pay, it's surprisingly nice, though a bit dusty. The apartment looks almost new, like someone had been keeping it in shape. Alright, enough lounging around. Time to get to work. I don't know who I am. I just saw a guy's face up there when I first started this game, so I have no idea what I'm getting into. You stand back up and let out a huff, preparing yourself to unpack the last box. The last box lands on the living room floor with a thud. You kneel to open it and your thoughts start to drift. You didn't exactly leave home on the best terms. You remember how he scorned your interest and pushes you to his predetermined path. He must be speaking of a father. That's typically what parents do. They try to push you down this path they think is best for you, but only you know what's best for you. Your father. The look on his face, cold, rigid, as if you were a fool for even daring to dream. He never understood. He never wanted to understand. To him, you were just a rebellious kid chasing a fantasy, not someone who has sacrificed your life just to meet his standards. Because you thought of being a good child meant giving up your own dreams. But even after everything that you've done for him, he's never been kinder. I swear, I know he's going through. Not even when he needed something, always expecting, always demanding. And that was a tipping point. You packed up what little you have and kept your plans to yourself until you find this place. Cheap and quiet, in a town so small that doesn't even show up on some maps. Wow. I'm not a city girl anymore. However, I am just... Gosh, phone. You always interrupted me. I'm not a city person anymore, but I can't not be in the middle of nowhere. I can't. But you don't care. The landlord had nothing bad to say about the place, and she seemed pleasant enough. Plus, it's closer for Abel to visit, which means hopefully he'll see you more often now. After a bit more arrangement, you look around the house again. For the first time in a long while, you feel a sense of accomplishment. Well, there you go. I'm happy for you. This is pretty nice. Finally, a place I can call my own. Uh-oh. A guest? You hear a knock on the door. Unexpected. Okay. You walk over and swing it open to find a smiling neighbor holding a cake. Welcome to the neighborhood. You notice their voice sounds overly chipper. I'm glad I gave them that voice then. And how their eyes darted nervously past you. We didn't think anyone would move in so soon. The place has been empty for a while. Did it say something? And it skipped? Yeah, it is skipping it. Heck, don't do that to me. Yeah, I was surprised too. It's a really nice place. Yeah, that's what it said. Right. Very nice. Anyways, welcome. We hope you like it here. Really. You hesitate on taking the cake they offered, but they thrust it into your hands. No, I throw that away. Yeah, he's just interrupting me like crazy. I don't really eat sweets. Oh, it's okay. Just enjoy the cake. It's what we do here. And yeah, good luck. You barely finish your sentence, but they're already waving you off with what looks like a forced smile. You feel a bit bewildered by the abruptness.
Why did they seem to be in such a hurry? Weird. You step back into the house and close the door behind you. Looks like you'll have to wait till next time to return the gesture. You set the cake aside and take one last sweeping glance around the room. The place is yours now. A place where you can feel fresh, away from the life you left behind. Well, I mean, at least eventually you'll have to make up with your father, or at least come to peace with how your father is and let it go. But right now, just enjoy the fact that you live alone now. Okay, I think this is a time to look for jobs.
You don't have a job?
You sink into your chair and open your laptop. You start thinking of the last job you had as you browse for new ones. Maybe quitting that job wasn't the best idea, but with the move, the commute would have been a nightmare. Maybe you do need a change of workplace for a really fresh start. A sigh escapes you as you start searching for remote work. You scroll through the job listings and find a few that looks interesting, but nothing quite grabs you. I promise you I'm working my butt off to get better equipment and everything so I can become a YouTuber so I don't ever have to do this again, because I'm doing this now and it is so exhausting. It is extremely exhausting. Just as you started to feel a bit discouraged, a video call notification pops up on your screen. You glance at the notification and see Abel's name. You hesitate for a moment before deciding to pick it up.
Oh, Abel. Hi, Abel. Isn't he cute? He's a cutie pie.
Hey, babe. How's the move going? Need any help? Abel's greeting sounds as familiar as ever. Hey babe, it's going okay, thanks. I just finished unpacking. What about you? You hear Abel let out a quiet chuckle and see him nod. That's great to hear. You know how it is for me, busy, busy. But hey, I'm close to landing an internship at this hospital. It's a big opportunity. Your eyes widen a bit in surprise. He always surprises you with his achievements. Wow, that's awesome, but isn't that place pretty far?
Yeah, it's gonna be a 4-hour round trip, wow.
So 8 hours daily on the commute. But don't worry, I'll still make time for you. Your new place is closer anyway, so it works out.
I mean, and if you staying in my place makes it closer to your job, you can always come stay at my place.
You've known your boyfriend, Abel, for years now. He has his moments of slacking off, but he always catches up in the end somehow. And just like now, surprising you with his achievements. You never quite so am I a girl or a boy?
I think I'm a guy.
You never quite question how he does it. He always ends up succeeding, no matter the challenges. I'm really happy you're landing that offer. Just please, don't overwork yourself, Abel.
Of course, babe. I'll be fine.
I'll make sure to see you soon, okay? Even if it's a bit busy, you're always my priority.
Oh, this is what we need, ladies. This is what we need.
You smile at his familiar words, a set of words you've heard many times before. I know you will. I'll be here whenever you're free. I'll make sure to call you more often so you don't miss me too much. I love you, darling. You smile at his words, and forgive me, guys, I am losing my voice. I love you too, Abel. You end the call and shift your focus back to the job search. You think about the conversation you just had with your boyfriend, letting out a small sigh as you do. Abel is like the exact opposite of you in many ways. He has it all. He had opportunities that you're still striving for. I mean, yes, I hate when people be like, oh, my life is so hard, and everybody has their own struggles. But some of us don't even know if we can pay our light bill in the next month or two. Some of us don't even know if we can pay our rent in the next month. But he would always assure you not to feel inferior to him, telling you that he'd help you along his way too.
Aw, that's so sweet.
That's what he always promised after all. That is so sweet. 30 minutes later, you can hear your stomach rumbling loudly, reminding you that it's well past time for dinner. You realize you haven't been looking at the clock up until now, but it's not like you've been entirely focused on the job search, honestly. You're procrastinating more than you'd like to admit. I mean, that's me too. You stand up and stretch while feeling the tension in your shoulders ease. You quickly head to the kitchen to cook something. Excuse me. You decide on making something simple. Heat up a frozen meal you've brought with you. It doesn't take long for your meal to be ready. You pick up the plate from the microwave. You bring your food to the living room, settling on the couch. Now, again, I don't remember what this game is about. There's so many games in Spooktober. This is a Spooktober game, too. There are so many games in Spooktober that I'm trying to keep up, but I'd be down. I'm like, ooh, this one looks cool. This one looks cool. And I download a bunch of them, and I'd be like, what was this one about again? And I can always bring up the page, but I'd rather go in surprised. So here we are. You bring your food to the living room, settling on the couch. You've never been able to stand doing anything without background noise. I mean, me neither. I need the TV running. It makes you uncomfortable when it gets too quiet. You reach for the remote and turn the television on. You begin to eat slowly with your eyes on the screen. You're not really paying attention to whatever's on the screen. You just needed a background noise. Understandable. You grip your spoon and begin to eat. A soft thudding noise comes from behind you. What? You freeze, your spoon hovering in mid-air as you turn around and scan the room. Your eyes flick down, expecting to see something has fallen. Maybe a book or a picture frame out of place? But no. Your gaze rests on the cabinet with the vase on top of it, and that's when you notice something's off. You raise from your seat to observe the dahlias in the vase. You notice something about it has changed now. They were pink. You're sure of it. But now, one of the flowers have turned a deep, unnatural shade of black. You feel a knot form in your stomach as the realization dawns on you. How is this possible? That's so weird. You had been looking forward to receiving these flowers from Abel, and now you try to make sense of it. Is it decaying? But flowers don't turn black when they wilt. They turn yellow, brown. You don't want to think too much about it, at least not for now. You reach out, crumbling the black dahlia and throwing it inside the trash can. It feels fresh between your fingers. It was not decaying at all. Its petals had just turned black for whatever reason.
I would be so terrified, I promise you. Nothing would stop me from being scared. By the way, the maintenance people are on their way to fix something in the apartment, and so if you hear a knocking, that's what it is. Afterwards, you immediately rinse the dishes and head straight for the shower.
You feel the hot water relax your body, giving yourself a calming sensation. You step out of the shower and dry off before slipping into your pajamas. You settle into the bed, fixing up your blanket and pillows before you get comfortable for the night. You stare at the ceiling for a moment, letting out a quiet sigh as you pull the blanket closer to your chest. You don't know what it is about this place. There's a quietness that you like, a sense of calmness that wraps around you like a soft embrace. But something about this place also makes you feel slightly uneasy.
Oof.
You drift off to sleep. Oh man, I could not sleep in a place like this. But you feel like someone is watching you.
No, I just wanted to sleep. Why would you do this? I just wanted to sleep. I just wanted to sleep.
You are not sure if you can move your body. You try to stay alert, but your eyelids feel too heavy. The figure only looms as you try to focus. Throughout the night, You feel someone's gaze watching your every move.
I would pack up immediately and leave. I'd go, Father, forgive me, please. I'm sorry.
The next morning, you're already sitting on the couch with your breakfast in one hand and cell phone in the other. You scroll through the inbox as you take small bites, hoping to see a response from the jobs you applied for yesterday. Nothing yet. Typical. A sigh slips out, but you remind yourself that these things take time. Switching over to your messenger app, you check to see if Abel has texted back. Still, nothing from him either. For a moment, you consider sending him another message, but you hesitate. No, he's probably just caught up with work. Okay. The sun is bright today. At least we get a bright sunny day. That's the best part. I'm already nervous. You take your minds off your worries and decide to take a walk around the neighborhood and to familiarize yourself with the area. The air feels cool with a light breeze that rustles your hair as you stroll. You pass a few familiar faces, same ones you saw your first walk after moving in. It's a small town, that much is clear. There aren't many houses in sight either, just trees and old withered homes. Even the place you're living in now feels aged, like it's been standing there for years. You get a sense that in a town like this, everyone knows each other. I do not like living in older houses. I don't. Especially the ones that creak, the floor creaks and stuff. Like, as y'all can hear, I don't know if y'all can hear, but my floor creaks in this house. I don't like it. And I have been looking into new things, new apartments and stuff, but one step at a time. And I've been dealing with a lot, so I have not moved yet, but God, I can't wait to move. I'm going to move in such like a newer apartment, a townhouse, a house. I don't care what it is. I don't like older houses. Older houses carry memories. I don't like that. Sometimes bad memories. You get the sense that in this town like this, everyone knows each other. I read that already. You wipe the sweat off your forehead and you shrug off your jacket as you step back inside your house. You notice a faint scent of something in the air. A cologne? But it's not one that you recognize. It's a lingering, distinct scent that feels out of place in your home. You pause and glance around, but everything seems normal. Oh man, if Abel snuck in here and he went and got some new Bath and Body Works, oh man, I'ma fight him. You focus and try to identify the scent, but it doesn't belong to anything, anyone you know. You feel the scent fade as you try to focus on it. Maybe it's an old scent from the previous occupant. You didn't clean the house head to toe. Let me tell y'all something that I learned as a kid and that I implement in my life now. When you first move into a house, I don't care if they say, oh yeah, we cleaned the floors, we cleaned the bathroom and everything. You do it now. You be like, okay, let me wipe the walls down. Let me clean the floor. It depends on if you have carpet. Not everybody has a carpet cleaner or whatever, but if you got, you know, wood floors or something, you clean the floors. You clean the bathroom. You clean the walls. You wipe down the whole kitchen head to toe. Okay? All right. You must have not cleaned this place as thoroughly as you thought. Cleaned it again. But you also don't remember ever smelling anything like that when you first moved in. If it were from a previous tenant, you would have noticed it before. I should probably clean this place better. You decide to do a little more cleaning before moving on, hoping that whatever caused the scent doesn't come back. Or what if our neighbor snuck in here? Oh, please don't tell me our neighbor's in here. Later that night, you return back into your job search. You still haven't heard back from any of the jobs you applied to. Though you've been at it for hours now, you can use a little break. You decide to unwind by browsing articles about the areas you moved to. That is such a bad idea. And then you're going to find out somebody got killed in here. hoping to familiarize yourself with the neighborhood, but you discover that there's not much to read either. The suburb's calm atmosphere is a far cry from the relentless energy of the city you used to live in. Compared to life back at your dad's place in the busy city, it's almost unsettling how calm this little town is. You get lost in reading, digging deeper into the history of this place. You feel curious about your new surroundings.
I'm not. I absolutely, like, I'd rather, if the owners didn't tell me of the house, I don't think I want to know.
After a while, you stumble upon an article from about a year ago. The past residents of a certain house on Cedar Street was found dead under mysterious circumstances 5 years prior. The young man, in his mid-20s, was discovered hanging in his home. I was going to say room.
It skipped. Nope. Nah. We're not doing that.
However, further investigations revealed that... There we go. Your phone suddenly buzzes with an incoming call from your father. Do we answer it? You stare at it, feeling anxiety settle in your chest. The memory of the last conversation you had with him makes you hesitant to pick up. You reach out to deadline the call. You reach out to decline the call, but before you can tap the screen, it disconnects on its own. You haven't even clicked the hang up button yet. Maybe he just decided not to call? Let's hope it was that. Maybe. You think it was strange, but you try to tell yourself that it might just be a glitch or an issue with the screen.
Just keep saying, what if it's this and maybe it's this, and just let it go until you get a reason to have to worry.
You let out a sigh and set your phone aside, picking up your journal instead. You flip to a fresh page. Journaling your thoughts and daily experiences has been somewhat helpful for regulating your emotions.
You know, I should start doing that. I think I might do that.
Often, your entries end up being more like random ramblings and venting than organizing thoughts. Organized thoughts, excuse me, I messed up. After a bit of writing, you set your pen down and decide to reread what you have written. What you've written today isn't exactly what you hoped for, but it's okay. I should get some rest. It's getting late.
As long as the body isn't looming over me again, I'm okay.
You close the book and decide that it's time for bed. All right, nighty night. That night, you find yourself back at the living room. Someone is flipping through the pages of your journal. Okay. I see. You with him. Whatever. You're the same as me. Just as I expected, huh? That man, too. Your diary entries are funny. Why do you keep so much to yourself?
Oh, man. Absolutely not. I'd be done. My body would leave.
When you could have shared your struggles with me. Is this Abel?
I think that's Abel.
You wake up earlier than usual this morning. You still feel tired, as if you barely slept at all. You had a strange dream last night.
Oh man, I think it was Abel.
It was so vivid. Someone was reading your journal and commenting on your entries. The relationship you have with your family, and then with Abel, among other things.
Okay, so maybe it's not Abel if they were commenting on Abel as well.
You climb out of your bed and rub your eyes while heading to your desk to check for any email replies from job applications.
Okay. We gotta check for our jobs, of course. I'm like uneased. Like, I feel like worried for some reason.
Your heart skips a beat when you see new emails from one of the places you applied to. Finally, a response. You quickly open the email and read through it. They want to schedule an interview.
Yes!
Just as you're processing the email, you received an incoming video call from Abel. Hey babe, good morning. I really have to share this immediately. Today was amazing. I got to assist an actual surgery. You smile, feeling a bit of his excitement through the screen as you speak. Wow, that's incredible. You must have been so nervous. Yeah, I was. But once I've got started, it all just clicked, you know? God, I'm still buzzing from it. I can imagine. You're really getting into the thick of it now. Totally. I'm so excited for the next time I'll assist the team. We have a lot more planned, and I get to talk to a famous neuro doctor too, which was just really cool. I'll be sure to tell you all about it later. But also, how's your morning going? Anything exciting on your end? You smile to yourself, nodding as you think about what to say. Actually, yeah, I just got an email for an interview from one of the jobs I applied to. No way, that's awesome. I knew you'd start getting responses soon. Abel's eagerness for the news makes you feel validated in a way. Again, that's all we need from our parents, from our relationship partners, whoever it is. We just want y'all to validate the fact that we actually like did something awesome. Thanks, Abel. I'm a little nervous though. You'll do great, I know it. Just be yourself and they'll see how amazing you are. You smile, widening at his encouragement. It's always hard to just take what everyone says to you as is, but you try to make an exception for Abel. You nod, your voice coming out a little quieter than expected. I hope so. Anyways, it's nice to hear from you. You're so sweet. I did tell you I'd call you more often from now on, did I? Also, hate to leave you so quickly, but I've got to go now. Don't worry about it. Thank you, Abel. I love you. I love you too. Go crush that interview. I think we needed that. We needed the encouragement from our partner. The room goes quiet as Abel hangs up. Okay, this is time for the interview now. Okay, did we do it? Say yes. The interview went well. It's a bit odd that you were hired on the spot, but at least you have a job now. I don't need to dwell on the negative. I should just be glad that I scored a job. Yeah, I mean, again, I am struggling to find one. Or just any type of income. Like, it sucks out there. The job market sucks. You tell yourself that, stretching in your seat and looking around your desk for your journal. But it's nowhere to be found. You keep looking around, but still can't find it. You were so sure that you put it on your desk last night. You step outside looking for it in the living room instead, despite thinking it's unlikely. You always put it back in the same place each time after you write, after all. But to your surprise, you find it there in the living room where you didn't put it. Again, I'd been gone. On the couch, sprawled open, like someone had been reading it. Someone? The sight of it immediately reminds you of the very vivid dream you had the other night. A dream where someone was flipping through your journal pages and commenting on your entries. You feel uneasy because the book is really here in the living room now, just like how it was in your dream. It really felt like it wasn't just a dream at all. You hastily pick up your journal and secure it in your grasp, sitting down on the couch. You take your pen and open the book, tapping the pen against the edge of the book and trying to find the right words to write. You hope journaling your thoughts right now would help you as a distraction from that weird dream you had. I would write down the dream in details. Every detail you remember, if you remember like, oh yeah, they had brown hair, I'd write that down. If you remember they had on a vest or, you know, some shorts, I'd write it all down. After a moment, you managed to start writing about your day eventually. Today, you landed an interview and secured a job. You also start jolting down thoughts about Abel and things that he mentioned about his internship. Huh? You feel a strange sensation creep up on you. Oh God. A cold gust of wind brushes the back of your neck. You pause your writing and set the book and the pen aside, looking up and glancing around the room frantically. Oh no. Your eyes land on the window, now slightly ajar and rattling softly in the wind. Oh no, the window decorations Abel gave me. It has flown away with the wind. No! You feel bad now. You can't recall whether you locked it or not. You decide to close it before continuing to write. I really liked it. I should have made sure I locked the window tight. As you settle back down and pick your journal up again, you notice a change in the air. The room feels much colder than it was earlier. You glance at the window again, thinking it must be the cause. But you peek outside. There's barely a breeze. The wind is almost non-existent. Oh, Spooktober. You sigh softly and try to focus on writing about Abel in your journal, but you still feel the chill from earlier. You shake your head and try again, yet you can't focus. For some reason, you keep wanting to glance over your shoulder repeatedly. A part of you expect to see someone there, because it certainly feels like someone is staring at you. I want to go home. I don't want to be here anymore. I want to go home. But, of course, there's no one. Oh, yeah, I am home. Oh, my God. I'm home. What were you thinking? You turn to your journal book again, trying to pour some more of your thoughts on paper. But despite the words in front of you, your mind keeps drifting back to what happened earlier. Is it just a lack of sleep finally catching up to you? You're not sure anymore what's causing it. Lack of sleep would just easily explain the paranoid thoughts you're having lately. You let out a sigh and put your journal aside, telling yourself that the mental exhaustion is all there is to it. No, it's not. It's not. Y'all better start listening to y'all gut. I am so serious. Y'all gonna end up like whatever happens to this person. There's no point in journaling if you can't even concentrate. Somebody's gonna end up in... Oh God, I got scared. I heard the footsteps. You carry your journal with you to the bedroom, and this time you make sure you put it on your bedside table. You still feel uneasy as you crawl under the covers and try to push away those thoughts. The way the journal just moved to the living room this morning. You glance at the journal one last time to make sure it's still where you left it. It's still there. Exactly where you left it this time. You turn the lights off and close your eyes. Okay. You're lying on your bed. The room is almost completely black, save for the faint shivers of moonlight slipping through the gaps in your blinds. You blink and try to adjust your eyes, but something feels off. You can't move your body. Oh, sweet Jesus, this man had climbed on top of me. This woman, this man, whatever, has climbed on top of me. You try to sit up and lift even a finger, but it's like you're frozen in place and trapped in your own flesh. It's a sleep paralysis. You glance around the room and see something moving near your bedside table. A slender figure holding a book. A book. It's your journal, is it? It's there, and it's watching you. No jump scares, please. This game did not say jump scares. I didn't hear anything about a jump scare. You can't see the eyes, but you feel them. Piercing, unblinking, fixated on you. I'm gonna cry. Y'all don't understand. I don't deal well with spookies. I cry. I just cry. The figure looms closer, but it doesn't seem to be walking. It glides instead. What is that? Is that your hand? What happened? Are you a victim of something? It reaches out its hand towards your face, just inches above your skin. The freezing contact of his hand. Oh, your skin leaves you.
with an uneasy sensation.
You finally, I can use. Oh, this will be interesting. Don't wake up yet.
You gasp, sitting up in your bed with cold sweats and heart pounding in your chest. It's morning already. You rub your eyes, trying to shake off the lingering unease from your dream. You don't know what it is that you saw in your dreams. You don't understand. It felt so real. That figure you saw in your dreams, the way it spoke to you, the way it touched you, all of it, it felt so cold. You can't concentrate on your job at all today. The dream still feels very fresh in your mind. You shake your head and try to put those thoughts aside, but you keep thinking back about it. You tell yourself to keep focus and just get the task done for the day because you'll be able to leave soon. I don't know how people can do it and just go back. I'd be calling Abel and crying and telling him I want to stay with him and everything. As the sun set and you clock out of work, you drag yourself into the kitchen with exhaustion. You think of making yourself something nice to unwind after the day. You stop in your tracks when you step inside. You spot your favorite drink, sits perfectly prepared on the counter, complete with a straw and a small variety of your favorite biscuits. Okay, if you're just gonna take care of me, that's fine, but can you show yourself? Are you ghost or are you human living in my walls? You don't remember setting this up even earlier in the day before. Did I? No. I didn't make this. You have mixed feelings, trying to recall if you prepared it earlier, but you're so certain you didn't. You want to question it further and find out, but you feel too tired to do that. You pick up the drink and take a long sip before sitting back. They could have poisoned it. It better not have been open. The cold, familiar taste brings a bit of comfort after a long day. She sucked that straw so deeply in my ear. You finish the snack and then you drink shortly after. You feel a bit more at ease now. You still don't want to think how those foods got out of the fridge, so you decide it's time to head to bed. I guess. It's been a few days since weird things began happening. The more it happens, the more you can't ignore it any longer. Things in your home keep moving, subtle but unmistakable. For example, those weirdly vivid dreams of a figure checking out your journal and trying to speak to you. I hope that the music isn't too low. I did turn the music down. No, it's up just fine, I think. Let's hope it is. The flowers Ava gave you rot so much faster, and the window keeps opening itself. The journal in particular is always open on the table, pages sprawled as if someone had been reading it. It's clear someone's been here. But it can't be an intruder. You're always here, and there's never any sign of a break-in.
I mean, it could be an intruder and he could be living in your walls. You guys, look that up. That's a thing. That is a real thing. It's scary too.
Your heart races as you scan the room again, searching for anything else out of place. You check the locks, the window, and everything is secured. There are no signs of forced entry, no clues that someone has been inside. And worst case scenario is a spirit. But the sense of intrusion lingers. Feels like more than a coincidence. Perhaps the house is haunted? After all, you did get this place at a suspiciously low price. Shaking your head, you try to dismiss the thought and sink into the sofa. Your eyes keep drifting between the clock and your phone. Abel should have been here an hour ago. He promised to visit you this week after all. But still, no message, no sign of him, nothing.
It's getting late. Oh, God. Hold on. It skipped. Maybe he's not coming after all. You hear a knock on the door. Is it Abel?
Abel! Oh, I'm so happy to see you.
It looks like Abel. Hold on. If you put the shadow picture up there, Voyia. It looks like Abel in the darkness. Well, I don't know. Y'all tell me what y'all think. You open the door and you see a familiar face. Abel, standing at your doorstep. He finally has the time to stop by your place. Hey, babe. I'm so glad I can be here, finally. You force a smile on your face to mask your disappointment at his lateness, although you can still feel it weighing on your heart deep down. Tell him. Just say, look, I'm so mad that you got here so late. Sorry. It has been so hectic for me. I would have texted and called you more often, but you know how things go in the internship, babe.
Oh, at least he's
trying to explain. It means he cares enough to explain. It's not that I didn't want to call you, okay? I just didn't have the time to. You just keep nodding as you hear Abel go on about his days while you welcome him inside your place. Nothing new. Excuses you've heard from him time after time. Again. Oh, and also, the two of you make your way inside and sit down on the sofa and face each other. But anyways, I'm glad moving out went smoothly for you. How has it been to live here? Tell Abel about the strange occurrence. Hide and brush. Tell him. Wait, hold on. Save it. Wait, save. Of course. I'm stupid. We save. Then we go back. Now tell him about the stuff. Actually, Abel, some weird things have been happening here. What happened? You hesitate for a moment. You're not sure how to phrase it properly. You don't want him to think that you're crazy. Because you know he doesn't believe in supernatural things. I bet my tongue said supernatural. My things, they were moved around. But there's no sign of anyone breaking in. Abel's expression hardens immediately at your revelation. Oh no. Wait, what? Why didn't you tell me sooner? I've told you to always tell me if anything happens. I don't want to find out this way. I knew it. Someone's watching you. I knew it. Huh? Wait, what? It's that guy. What guy? Hold on. It's surprising to hear him curse under his breath with such resentment. That creep. I knew it. He's been hanging around. Oh my God, the skipping of the stuff. Should have never let him alone, excuse me.
No, Abel. It's not like that. There were no signs of anyone getting in. I'm telling you, it's not some stalker. It's a ghost.
Abel stares at you like he didn't quite hear you right.
A ghost? What makes you think so? Ghost doesn't exist.
You shake your head at his words, hoping for him to hear you out.
It's true. The strange things keep happening, and I've been having the most bizarre dreams lately. The flowers you gave me, they wilt and rot so quickly no matter how fresh they are. The decorations you gave me, they blew away in the wind.
Are you catching the pattern? The things that he's giving you is what's happening. It's like something's happening to them.
Even though I swear I locked the windows. My journal, someone's been reading it. I know because I've seen it in my dreams. And then, even my snacks. I'm starting to feel like something is watching me. Like I'm not alone, even when the room's empty. There's something in this place. I don't know what it is, but it's always there. I tried ignoring it because, yes, ghosts don't exist, right? But I can't keep pretending anymore. Something is wrong. This place seems perfectly quiet, spacious, really cheap. But now I think it makes sense. Maybe this is why it was so affordable. Abel's expression turns sour as you explain. You can tell that he's still not sure about believing what you just told him.
I don't even know how to explain, like, hey, there's a ghost in my house. Like, I wouldn't even know how to explain it. He would have to see it for himself. Like, I would have to show him things happening. Did you even check the history of this place before moving in? No, I mean, kind of. There was this news piece I found. It talks about someone dying close by, but nothing specific. You realize you didn't finish reading the article last time you stumbled upon it. You can't even remember the vague details. I'll look into it later. But for now, you need to get out of here fast. Wait, what? Where are we going?
Anywhere but here.
And I haven't even finished paying for this place. To my place. Don't worry about the rent. I'll cover it. I just want you to be safe, okay? Abel's tone leaves no room for argument. He's already on his feet, grabbing your things and shoving it into your bag. But, no buts, trust me, okay? I know what's best for you, love.
This is gonna make her hate him.
You can see the way his hands shake slightly as he packs your things. Whatever's going on with the house, Abel clearly believes is serious. Okay? The car hums softly as you sit beside Abel, who focuses on the road ahead. Just be careful next time, alright? I can't have you getting caught up in whatever mess this is. I don't think he believes us that it's a ghost. I think he strongly believes we're being stalked. His voice is firm, but there's no undercurrent of worry that you've never heard before. But he also seems weirdly very agitated. But why? What? Why are you in such a hurry? I could have packed my things properly. It's just dangerous there. You understand? I promise you I'll look into some house history later, but I just have to get you out of there first. You don't have to worry about anything. You don't understand why he's worried now. Usually, he's more laid back, more patient, even when you tell him something is bothering you. Oh, man. It's like he knows something that we don't. But seeing him like this, you realize just how much he cares. Okay. You feel bad for doubting him up until now. Months pass, and life in Abel's spacious home feels different, comfortable. The regret of not asking for his help sooner gnaws at you. His place is so much nicer and safer. You never doubt his feelings for you anymore now. You feel like ever since you moved to his place, the two of you have gotten so much closer. Good luck at work today, Abel. Thank you. I'll make time for you tonight, okay? We need to go out on a date soon. I'm sure it has been a while. You smile and let him kiss you one more time before he finally leaves. You turn around to return to your room, feeling relieved. But you suddenly feel a sudden, searing pain shoot through your head, like something knocked you over. Ugh! The echoing throb that makes you wince. Took you long enough to notice, huh? Crowley? Who are you? Oh my goodness, what are you? This time it's my turn to ruin your life over. You think I left? You recognize this voice echoing in your head. It's Crowley's. Feels like an impressive force is wrapping around you like a vice. Stop! No. I didn't want to do it this way, but I guess I have to. Abel doesn't deserve to be happy. Crowley? You try to fight it, but you're not strong enough to. Your voice falters as his presence suffocates you. Is this an ending? A bad ending or something? Abel arrives home, the weight of the day hanging heavily on him. Hey baby, I'm home. Welcome home. Welcome back home. That text is green. You walk forward with a smile on your face, greeting Abel as usual with warmth. You're holding a knife behind your back. Abel, don't step closer.
It must be a long day, darling. Why don't I give you a hug?
You're being very sweet. Of course I would like to hug you.
No! You don't want to hug him. Not this way. Not when you're holding a knife in your hand, hidden behind your back, ready to stab him. Come here, Abel.
You see Abel chuckle at an affectionate tone as he steps closer to you with his arms open.
Jesus.
No!
You step back, still holding onto the knife that is now stained with Abel's blood.
A knife, babe? What? Why did you just...
Crowley's voice strokes your thoughts, urging you to stab him even stronger. He deserves this. He's always taking everything from you, too. Your time, your life, your love, it's about time you take something back. We're similar in a way.
Babe, why did you just...
You just stop right in front of Abel. He looks at you with the wide, terrified eyes, pleading slightly. I feel so bad.
No, Abel, no. I don't want to stab him again, no.
But your body moves forward again, ready to land another stab on him.
No, I don't want to do this. No, no, please.
Okay. Ending 3 of 3. Of course I get ending 3 of 3.
Dot, dot, dot. Let's go back in, I guess. So this time I hide it and brush it off. It's all right. The place has been treating me well. The neighbors have been nice to me too. Abel smiles, looking relieved that you're not showing signs of being troubled.
Good, good. I was a little worried.
I'm sorry I had to stop for a second. I was having the mildest of a panic attack, and I didn't want you guys to worry. I also had to get some water because I was losing my voice real bad. Not feeling too good today, but, you know, I'm trying to take it easy. I'm trying to, you know, relax with some of these Spooktober games. So bear with me, you guys.
Good, good. I was a little worried. I think I already read that. But let's not get caught up in all that.
His eyes roam around the place for a moment.
You've got a cozy setup here. Feels warm.
Thank you, Abel. I'm glad you think so.
Oh, God.
Whoa.
Remember when I said I was trying to relax? I don't think I'll be able to.
Your heart skips a beat. Someone stands behind Abel, staring at him. But before you can focus, the figure disappears already. It reminds you of the shape you saw in your dreams. You shake your head and focus back on Abel.
Oh, my babe, about last year, you know, I still owe you that birthday gift. I was meaning to make it up to you.
That sounds great, Abel. You smile, but it feels forced, like muscle memory than genuine excitement. You're no longer excited for any of the things he said.
It's been hectic lately, you know, but things are calming down. We'll finally have time to do all the things that we've been talking about. Remember the trip we planned too? I'm serious this time. We'll make it happen. I know I've been busy, but you're always my priority.
You just nod. He says it so casually as if it's the first time he's making these promises. Missed birthdays, missed date plans. You've heard it all before. Last year, the year before that.
Is the person potentially possessing them now, or are these having these thoughts without the person possessing them? Because then that's a little worrisome.
You keep hoping things will change, even when deep down you know better. That's why you're still here.
I get it, Abel. Don't worry about it.
No, seriously, you deserve something special. Soon. I promise. You know how his voice perks up, trying to distract you with his new promises. How about we do something fun together now? You look a little tired. Come on, let's watch a movie and cuddle or something. I know it's your favorite thing.
If only you knew what I've been going through in this freaking apartment.
You sit together on the couch while Abel's arms lazily wrap around your waist. The glow on the TV flickers in the room as a horror movie plays. It's playing something about an exorcist battling an evil spirit. Absolutely not. I would not be watching that. Not in the dark. But your mind just drifts off elsewhere. The scene on the TV reminds you of the strange occurrences in your home. A priest trying to banish a malevolent spirit from a house gives you an idea. Maybe you can call an exorcist to look into the place as well. Honestly, don't believe in ghosts, but these movies are always fun to watch. Abel's voice pulls you out of your thoughts.
I want to know, are you guys the type of people that believe that horror movies are cool to watch? Are they fun to y'all?
I don't know. Maybe it's because I'm an overthinker. I have anxiety. I also struggle with ADHD. Maybe it's because I have the freaking triangle of what the heck is going on in my brain that I can't watch horror movies and just be okay. But there are some people that be watching horror movies and they just be like, oh, this is so fun. I love the jump scares. And I'm like I slow pan towards them and be like, what did you just say? No.
I know you don't, love. You never believed in spiritual things. All you remembered.
Yes, I don't. They're ridiculous. But you know, I won't ever mind watching these kind of stuffs with you, babe. It's for your entertainment after all.
You just smile at his words, finding his voice feeling a little forced.
Oh, but are you enjoying this one in particular? You seem a bit out of it.
You're being kind of quiet tonight. What's wrong?
Abel sits the bowl of snacks aside and leans closer to you, his eyes searching yours.
Oh, no, I'm just a little tired.
He pulls you closer, pressing a soft kiss to your cheek.
Aww. It seems like Abel really does care. It's just that, you ever heard of too little too late? When you constantly keep promising things to people, when you constantly keep doing bad things, and then being like, this time, babe, this time I'll be good.
Sometimes it just doesn't work out because it's too late, too little too late. You've waited too long to try to change your behavior and stuff. And I think that's where our main character is getting into. They're getting into that thought like, you've been promising all these years, you've been doing a whole bunch of stuff. So, you know, with all that being said, I'm good. I'm so good off of you. Sorry if y'all heard me move my mic. I was getting it a little closer.
His affection doesn't reach you the way it usually does. You're tired, aren't you? Let me make it better.
How? We sucking toes? Or what? How are you making it better?
You're too tired to say anything. You push the strange feelings aside and just let Abel continue despite the unease gnawing at you.
Continue what? Is he massaging my back? Let's say he's massaging my back.
The morning light filters through the curtains, waking you up.
Abel's arms drape lazily across your waist, his lips brushing against your neck, if I say cheek, lard.
Morning, babe.
You stir, pulling yourself out of the haze of sleep.
Morning.
We really needed that, didn't we? I don't know what I'd do without you. You already know this moment won't last. He isn't here for you, just for the convenience of having you.
Wow.
Oh, man. Yeah, I don't think we're possessed yet because as you can see that the writing is still white. When we were possessed by what's his name? I can't remember his name because I the first part of this I played like an hour ago. So I don't remember the person's name, but the green text is what was like telling us like, hey, we're possessed or whatever. But now it's like, it's all us. This is us thinking this.
You're always there for me. And I'm so grateful for you. Be patient. We'll make more time together soon, okay?
His words feel sweet but empty, like a sugar coating of something shallow.
Yeah, sounds good.
Hello? You know, I've got this offer coming right up and... Okay.
Yeah, you told me that before.
The words slip out before you can stop them. He blinks at you, as if surprised by the bite in your voice.
Oh, did I? I'm sorry, babe.
I just want to keep you in the loop. You're my priority. You nod, tired of arguing. You know why he was late last night, out with co-workers, spending time and money on them. You saw his friend's status updates on his social medias, after all. He talks like he cares, but his actions tell you a different story. Fellas, on this channel, I want y'all to know something. Your actions will always speak louder than your words. I will say that again. Your actions will always speak louder than your words. Ladies, your actions will always speak louder than your words. You could be the most soft-spoken, quietest person in the world. And as long as you show your partner that you love them, they know. Trust me, they know. He talks like he cares. Okay, we already read that. You force a smile, lean in to kiss him softly, even though your heart isn't in it. It's okay, Abel. I understand. Thank you. I look forward to everything you have planned out for us. Excuse me. I was trying not to cough. You see his gaze immediately softens like your compliance reassures him. You're so understanding. I love you so much. I love you too. The words sting in their falseness, but you nod. He kisses you again as if that's enough to keep you around. And maybe it is for him. I'll be back soon, babe. You know I hate leaving you. I hope you have a good day, love. The front door closes and the silence that follows is deafening. You lie still and feel the emptiness returning, heavier than ever now. The sheets feel colder without him. Whew. This hits home for me. I dealt with a relationship like this where I was saying all the right things, but my heart was just like, no. No, absolutely not. I should shower now. You drag yourself out of bed with a loud sigh. You twist the faucet and let warm water crusade down your body. I was trying so hard not to sneeze. I got it though. I caught that thing. It always helps you calm down. Still, your mind wanders back to Abel amidst the stillness. You know this is how it's always going to be. Abel will come into your life only to leave again while you wait and wait. But the truth is, you can't seem to free yourself from his hold. After a few minutes, you finish up and step out of the shower. You towel yourself off and change into a fresh change of clothes. On your way to your bedroom to unwind, you freeze. You spot an unfamiliar figure standing in a corner of your vision. You blink and suddenly the figure materializes right in front of you. Hello? You are cute. This is who I saw and this is who I thought I was, but I guess I'm not that person. What the? The voice falters as you take in the figure standing before you. Oh, come on. No need for the dramatic reaction. Your heart races as you realize what you're seeing. This isn't a person, it's a ghost. Okay. I think I'm here for this. I don't know what I'm here for, but I'm here for this, I guess. Who? What are you? The ghost sighs, rubbing his neck while glowing green eyes studied you. Chill out, okay? I'm not here to hurt you. Crowley, that's his name. Oh my goodness, can I remember his name? My name's Crowley, and yeah, I'm a ghost. Crowley, what do you want? He sighs again, his form flickering slightly as he glides closer. Look, I know this is freaky, but I'm not here to scare you. Well, not in a haunt you kind of way. I do live here though, so technically, yeah, I guess I do haunt you. But right now, I'm trying to protect you.
Protect me from what?
Well, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Is he talking about Abel? Oh, man. Is he like, know that Abel's a bad person? Have you noticed anything strange lately? Stuff moving around? Feeling like you're being watched?
You nod slowly, the unsettling memories of recent days flooding back.
It does that thing all the time. I swear, this game makes me angry. Yeah, but I... Listen, I know all about that, alright? You brought something else with you when you moved in. A bad spirit. It's been messing with this place, and I've been trying my best to keep it at bay, behind the scenes. And I'm just supposed to believe you? Really can't just bring yourself to believe a ghost word so easily. I know, it's a lot to take in, but I'm telling you the truth. Really, I'm not the one you should be worried about. But you made me stab Abel.
Carly was the one that made me stab Abel. I don't know. We'll keep a close eye.
There's something else here, and it's not going to leave you alone unless I help. It's a dangerous spirit, one that could harm actual human beings. Its presence is bothering my place as well. I've been doing what I can to make it leave.
Okay.
You stare at him, unsure of what to say now. His eyes, though not entirely human, seem earnest. I can get rid of it for you. No hassle, but you have to trust me. I know what you were thinking. No exorcists, okay? Believe me, they'll only make things worse for us. You don't know what to believe. Could he be telling the truth? The thought of a spirit being here, especially one with malicious intent, scares you more than it should. Do I really have a choice? You can feel Crowley's gaze remain fixated on you. Please, let me help you. You swallow hard and try to weigh your options. The idea of trusting the ghost feels insane, but the alternative? You think to yourself that you should ask some more questions from him to really gauge his intentions. You know, I'm not stupid. Who said that you're stupid? Carly looks at you with a hint of surprise, looking almost offended at what you were implying. How do I know that you're telling the truth? You could be the one doing all of this, and you... I mean, she's got a point, yeah. And that you're just claiming to be a good guy. Yeah, he could be like, oh yeah, so now the next thing you need to do is move all your crap out of here, and then tell them that this house can't be moved in ever again. Are you serious? Look, I'll be blunt. If I wanted to hurt you, I could have done it already.
He's got a point. He's standing right in front of us.
But I don't. I'm stuck here, bound to this place. So really, I've got no choice but to keep the spirits away from this place.
His pair of sharp green eyes pierces into yours. So you just want me to agree and let you stay? Then what? You're just going to protect me out of the goodness of your heart?
This is my place, mind you. Let me repeat it again. I am bound to this place. I can't just go hunt somewhere else. Think of it like a cat protecting its territory. This place is my home. So yeah, I want to keep it comfortable for me too. Bad spirits hanging around don't exactly help with that. That aside, you're in danger. And as a ghost, I know how to handle my kind better than humans. I'm your best shot at getting rid of the thing without making it worse. If you call an exorcist, they might just stir it up, making it angrier. You could die in the process. Or maybe hurt the people around you, or really anyone that visits this place.
Or we could end up dead and stuck here and bound to this place like you. And then you have two more ghosts with you, and there'd be three of us in there.
His words make you think of Abel. What if the ghost goes after him? He just left earlier, but the thought lingers. You glance at him again, gauging his intentions. He doesn't look like an evil ghost, but can you be sure?
Or I could just call an exorcist to get rid of both of you.
You say you want to help, but you're a ghost too.
Carly lets out a dry laugh, shrugging.
Groundbreaking insight there. Of course I'm a ghost. And yes, you can call an exorcist, but that's a gamble. An exorcist, a priest, whatever, might not know the difference between me and the real threat. They could banish me and leave you defenseless against whatever's really haunting you.
So what do I do? Just let you stay here and hope you're not lying?
It's your call. But if you let me stay, I'll prove it to you. I'll keep you safe, and you won't have to worry about that other spirit anymore. But if you choose the other way, well, find out for yourself. What will you do? Another save. Another lovely save. Listen to crawling. Keep the exercising. I don't know. I've got a mild story for you guys, and it involves the maintenance people coming here. But you know what? I don't care right now. Right now, we're going to keep the exercise coming. We're going to do this part just simply because... Wait a second. Did I save? I did. Good. Because I feel like this is an ending, and it's better off if we just get it out the way. No, I'm not taking any chances. The exorcist is coming, and they're going to deal with all of this, including you. What? You straighten your spine, injecting as much firmness into your voice as possible, even though fear churns inside you. I swear I'd be scared. You notice a shift in Crowley's expression as well as the tension in the air. That's a mistake. You have no idea what you're getting yourself into. All I know is that I can't trust some ghost who shows up unannounced and expects me to believe he's a good guy. Huh, and you think some stranger waving across and chatting in Latin will solve everything? Sure, they might get rid of me, but that other spirit? It'll just get stronger, more violent. A poltergeist isn't something you joke about. A flicker of doubt creeps through you at his words. I think he might be right. I don't care. I'll take my chances. Hush, phone. At least I'm doing something more trustworthy instead of trusting a ghost covered in blood with a noose around his neck. She's got a point. She got a freaking noose around your neck. You just chilling and stuff. Oh, we're judging by appearance now. You don't know anything about me, about what I've been through. I was just trying to help you. But if you want to be stubborn, fine. Just don't say I didn't warn you. Is that a threat? Crowley lets out a shallow chuckle that feels bitter to you. Consider it advice. Good luck with the exorcism. Before you can respond, you see the form begins to waver. But his sharp, disdainful gaze remains fixed on you. You're just as stupid as your boyfriend is. Wait. You don't quite catch his last words, and he's already gone. A heavy weight settles in your chest as his presence fades from the room. You try to shake it off. You tell yourself like a mantra that you made the right choice. It's fine. Everything will be fine once the exorcist gets here. There's hope. I hope you're right about this. The following day, evening. You had decided to pay a visit to the nearby church the other day and got in contact with someone named Father Lucian. The knocking sound echoes through the quiet house, startling you out of your nervous pacing. Here goes nothing. All right. You take a deep breath, steadying yourself before heading to the door. As you open it, you're greeted by a tall, imposing figure dressed as in a priestly robe. I mean, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Greetings. I'm Father Lucian. Did you call for an exorcist? You nod, swallowing the lump in your throat. Yes, that's me. Thank you for coming on such short notice. Why has he got his hand out? Like, put your hand down, sir. We haven't even started yet. Relax. Let's not waste any time then. Show me where you've noticed the disturbances. You lead him through the house, pointing out the areas where things have moved and spots where the unsettling occurrence have happened. It's mostly been here, in the living room and in my bedroom. But sometimes I feel like I'm being watched, like there's someone else here with me. These feelings of unease are common in cases of spiritual disturbances. Okay. I'll need to perform a cleansing ritual throughout the house. It should take care of any lingering spirits. You nod and try to remain composed, even though your anxiety is evident in the way your hands tremble slightly. Will it be dangerous? Father Lucian gives you a reassuring look. There is always some risk dealing with spirits, especially if they are malevolent. But with God's blessing, everything will be all right. Please allow me. With that, he begins his preparations, drawing out various tools from a leather bag. They look like some candles, holy water, a crucifix, and a small bundle of sage. Now, I'm not mistaken. I don't know. So, any religious people out there, please let me know. I could have sworn that sage is witchcraft stuff, not spiritual Christian or any of that stuff. Like, it's not, you know, church related. Sage is not church related, is it? I thought that was like witchcraft, like people use it in witchcraft. Y'all can let me know in the comment section below. I'm not for sure. I really don't know. I'm not even joking around. I really don't know. But y'all can let me know in the comment section below. He lights the candles and murmurs prayers under his breath. Okay. I command you, spirit, reveal yourself. You're not welcome here. Your breath catches in your throat as you recognize the shadowy figure you've seen before in your dreams. You should have listened. It wasn't me, please. Crowley, stay back. Father Lucian raises the crucifix, his chant becoming a fierce command. Crowley's form flickers, but his gaze never leaves yours. This won't end well for you. You're making a mistake. In the name of the Holy Spirit, I banish you from this place. Okay. He got rid of the wrong spirit, but okay. Father Lucian lowers the crucifix, his chest heaving as he catches his breath. There was indeed two spirits, one more stronger than the other. Thank you, Father. Is it really over? For now, yes, but I'll leave you with these protection charms. Stay vigilant. May God bless you. You accept the items with trembling hands, trying to convince yourself that it's finally over. It's over like that? You look at the holy water in your hands and sigh softly. The hunting is over, at least for now. It's really hard to believe any of this had happened in the first place. It feels so surreal. You place the charms on the table and head for the bathroom. Okay, so maybe it did work. Maybe he was lying, but there's three endings, so I'm gonna get all three endings. You start showering, letting the water cleanse your body. All right, nice little shower. Wash, wash, wash. Once you're done, you put yourself into a fresh change of clothes and head towards the living room to put on a show. Someone is knocking on the door. Your heart skips a beat before you realize who it must be. Abel? Abel's back again? Hey, babe, I saw a priest on my way here. Was he leaving your place? You pause, unsure of how to explain the events that of the past few days. Without thinking, you step forward and wrap your arms around him, resting your head against his chest. Yeah, there's been a ghost. I didn't tell you sooner because I wasn't sure you'd believe me. Abel looks down at you, his brows furrowed for a moment.
A ghost? Silly. You know we don't believe in that stuff. They don't exist.
Despite this dismissive tone, he tightens his hold around you as he leads you inside. Now here's my thing. Why is Crowley so fixated on hurting Abel? That's the thing I want to know. You whisper his name as you leap up to kiss him. His eyes lighten up in surprise, but he smiles and kisses you back. You look happy this evening. You smile against his lips, sinking into the comfort of his embrace. Let's step inside first, okay?
Sure, sure, sure. Just don't murder me, because I murdered you first.
The next morning, you blink awake and sit up. You look to the side and see Abel by your side. Your heart still feels heavy with the remnants of last night's event.
Holly's voice lingers in your mind. You still remember how his presence feels. But you shake it off and turn to Abel, who's still asleep beside you. You convince yourself that it was all just a bad dream. Without thinking, you wrap your arms around him and buries your face in his chest. Hey, it's been a while since you've been this clingy. Are we being clingy? Is the ghost being clingy to kill Abel again? I don't know how this works, because I don't understand why Crowley did what he did. I mean, well, he already showed a few times that he does not like Abel for some reason. We don't know why, but he doesn't like Abel. So, oh man, I can't wait to learn the backstory between both of them. He looks down at you with a soft smile, his hand brushing gently through your hair. You can't help but hold him tighter. You don't want to think about Crowley again. I'm just scared of ghosts, I guess. Your voice trembles and Abel tightens his hold on you while pressing a gentle kiss on your forehead. But I think we're okay now, right? Yes, we're all right, darling. Everything's okay. Ghosts don't exist, okay? You nod and decide to believe him, to believe that Crowley is truly gone and that everything is finally returning to normal. Let's get you a distraction, okay? Speaking of, I do want to show you something I found.
What is it?
Abel pulls away slightly and reaches for his phone, scrolling for a moment before turning the screen towards you. On it is a picture of a black cat, its glossy fur and piercing eyes staring back at you. I made up my mind. I want to adopt this cat instead. I thought that was outside. That is inside the house. Okay. I didn't know you liked black cats. Didn't you say they were scary? You raise your eyebrows, surprised by Abel's sudden enthusiasm. He had always mentioned black cats made him uneasy before. Nah, they're cute, you know.
Y'all hear the creaking. I promise y'all that's not in my house. That is in this game. That is not me. Let me make sure y'all can hear, because... Oh, y'all can hear that for sure. The music may be iffy because I turned it down a little bit, but then I turned it up to make sure y'all could hear it. But I don't know. It skips something. It skips something. Now the cute, you know. Abel grins. Okay, wait. I think it didn't skip. Abel grins, tapping on the picture affectionately. I just thought a pet would help us not feel so lonely. And well, it could be good for us, right? Something to bond over? I think I see Crowley in you. He's still smiling, but for a brief moment, his expression changes. Oh, okay. For just a second, Crowley's familiar smile overlaps Abel's face. Mischievous, taunting. You freeze, a shiver running down your spine. Please don't jump at me. Your heart pounds, the weight of realization hitting you like a ton of bricks. Crowley isn't gone. He's still here, and he's part of Abel now.
Abel?
You try to speak, but words catch in your throat. Oblivious to your internal panic, Abel just chuckles and smiles as Crowley stares at you through his eyes. So, what do you think? Should we get the cat?
Ending 1 of 3. Dead lover.
So it said dead lover, though. Is it really still Abel who's with you?
Huh. That was actually kind of cool. Let's go get the other one. So this time, as much as I don't want to, I'm gonna go and listen to Crowley. You know why? Because Crowley is Crowley, I guess, and he's cute. He's cuter than Abel, so.
All right, you can stay, but I'm watching you. You cross your arms, trying to project confidence despite the tremors in your voice. Trusting a ghost isn't exactly something you ever thought you'd be doing. Now that's all I ask. Give me a chance, so I'm going to prove it to you.
Are you like an ex-boyfriend of mine or something?
No, because she would
because I thought that this was the person that Abel was talking to on the phone. So she would absolutely know for sure if this was her ex-boyfriend, especially because he had a noose on him and blood and stuff. Of course she would know. He hovers a step back, looking oddly proud of himself for earning your trust. So, what happens now? There's a ritual we can do to get rid of this thing once and for all. And how exactly do we do that? You watch as Crowley runs a hand through his messy black hair, the noose around his neck swaying slightly as he does so. Again, I say, I'm a little worried about this. I'm scared and worried at the same time. I was turning up and down if y'all heard a slight change in the music or anything. We just need a couple of things for the ritual. It's not as dramatic as it sounds, but it'll bind the spirit and expel it from here and give this place a temporary protection. And then what about you? I'll guide you through it when the time's right. You still feel a bit skeptical. Fine, but no weird surprises, okay? You stay out of my personal space when I do my own stuff. I hear him chuckle, a sound that surprisingly lacked any malice. I've always been an unobtrusive ghost, even all this time, you know. You feel his gaze linger on your face a little longer than it should. Well, catch you later. Yeah, I think that Crowley might have a crush on me. Oh, wait. Before you can finish, he already disappears into thin air. The cold, uneasy feeling in the room lifts as his presence fades. What a weird interaction. A few days later. Let me guess, Abel shows up. Oh, no. Tonight is the day of the ritual. The other day, Crowley had told you about the things that he'd need to perform the ritual. You learned that you can feel his presence in the room even without spotting him. Crowley is hovering nearby, his sharp eyes scanning the room. I could never perform the ritual myself. Because I'm a ghost, I can't touch any items, so I'm just here to guide you. You'll have to do exactly what I say, understand?
Yeah, sure. What do you need me to do?
We need 3 items, the candles, the salt, and something personal to you. A token that ties you to its place.
No. Absolutely not. This sounds more like, what do you need my items for? What about your items? Why don't we need your items?
And one more thing. A photo of someone you care about deeply. I told you it will help strengthen the protection ritual.
I don't understand. The candles and the salt, I get. But what do you need? An item of mine? And what do you need, like, I don't get it. Like, that's the part that makes me uneasy about all of this.
You prepared that one, too, for tonight, right?
Yes, I have it here.
Good. Now put it there, along with the other items. You hesitate. The only one that comes to mind is Abel.
You nod and place it on the ground where Crowley floats nearby.
Good. Now place the candles around the photo, and the pendant and the salt.
This sounds a whole lot like I'm doing something I shouldn't be doing.
You do as he says, setting the candles carefully.
Next, pour the salt a little more around the room.
You begin pouring the salt, moving slowly and deliberately.
Now, move the photo of your loved one in the center of the circle so it's on top of everything else. These will act as your anchors, your guide during the ritual. You two love each other and will always want the best for one another, right? Does Abel really want the best for me?
That's a question too.
You swallow hard and nod, adjusting Abel's photo. The smiling photo of Abel feels almost out of place in this eerie setting, but you trust Crowley's instructions.
Stand in front of the circle and hold on to the pendant. Close your eyes and focus on the connection you have to this place and to the person in the photo. Pour your intent into it, protection, safety, anything positive. You stand still and clutch the pendant tightly. Your heart races as you close your eyes and try to focus.
unable image flashes in your mind. Good. Now, repeat after me.
Carly begins to chant in a low voice. You don't understand the language. The words are unfamiliar, but you mimic them as best you can.
Keep going. You're doing fine.
You feel the tension in the air shifts heavier. Oh my God, he's taking over me, I bet. You continue chanting as your voice starts to tremble slightly.
The candles flicker, their flames stretch towards the ceiling as if reacting to the power in chanted words. For a moment, you can't feel Crowley's presence anymore.
Crowley?
You want to open your eyes and look around, but you suddenly feel his presence again, now right behind you. His presence seemed to grow stronger now, more imposing than earlier.
Focus. You can't see it, but I can. Don't let it distract you.
Okay. You squeeze the pendant tighter, your voice growing louder and more confident as you continue to chant. The room trembles slightly, and you can feel the spirit's anger, its frustration, and being held at bay.
Almost there. Just a bit more.
With one final burst of energy, you follow Crowley's lead and shout the last words of the chant. Everything is silent now.
Why do I feel like he took over my body?
That was my first thought, is that he's trying to take over my body for some reason. I mean, not for some reason. He just don't like Abel for some reason.
The oppressive presence that had been bearing down on you fades away, leaving behind a sense of calm.
Open your eyes.
Okay, he didn't take over my body.
You nod and follow Crowley's order, opening your eyes slowly and meeting his gaze with a faint smile.
It's done. The spirit won't bother you anymore.
It was just a poltergeist.
A poltergeist? Just like that?
You ask, letting go of the pendant and setting it aside.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's all you can do from your end.
The rest? I'll handle it like usual.
Well, if you got nothing else to say, why don't you take your leave?
Being in an attic as dusty as it is shouldn't be nice for your lungs
and nose. Now you're worried about my well-being too? I thought you said you just wanted to protect your house.
Well, what about you?
Doesn't matter to me. I can't even feel the sunlight anymore.
Now, go and rest up. Sleep. You humans need sleep.
You're quite the loner type, aren't you?
Oh, his little smile. His face looks trustworthy, but I mean, what he did in the first ending, in the third ending technically, and then in the first ending, and I'm sure we're leading our way into the second ending. I never do it right the first time. But it makes me worried.
You can see Crowley's eyes widen momentarily as you say so, but he quickly grins and shrugs again.
A black hat is possessing me. That's why I'm acting like one.
You chuckle softly at his words. Now I understand why black hats are always associated with spooky things. It's because of you.
He shrugs at you and smiles smugly.
I'm a little worried.
You decide to leave the attic. You wonder if it's really going to help.
He did say that he was on your side, but you still can't feel like you fully trust his words.
Maybe you can see it next morning, in the following weeks from now on.
You can no longer feel Crowley's presence.
Or maybe he was trying to give it to himself.
A few days later.
Okay, we didn't die on the first night.
In the days following the ritual, you notice a gradual shift in the atmosphere in the house. The odd occurrences that once plagued the daily life became less frequent.
The unsettling feeling that you had grown accustomed to has also faded away, now replaced by a sense of calm.
It's as if the house is finally settling into a peaceful mode. You start to feel more at ease and reassured by Crowley's promise and the noticeable lack of disturbances.
That's a good thing, though. That's a good thing. See, this all happened in a few days. Maybe we can trust him.
No more disappearing items, misplaced things, weird noises, hovering shadows, weird dreams, nothing. It seems that
Befriending Crowley and following his instructions led to a good outcome. You smile to yourself, feeling glad that you've made a right decision. You never mention Crowley nor the ritual to Abel. You always consider telling him over the phone, but then think better of it. You don't want to worry him or complicate things unnecessarily. Moreover, he told you himself that he doesn't believe in ghosts. You don't want him to think that you've gone crazy. I'm sorry, a little dot popped up on my screen. It scared me, but it has nothing to do with the game. I hope not. I don't know. I moved the mouse, but it's not moving away, so I don't know what that was. Everything is fine now, so that's all that matters. At least everything's good now. You set your dishes in the sink and see Crowley there as you turn around. I told you it would work. You huff and smile, nodding at the smug way he said it. Looks like your little ritual worked wonders. The place feels normal again. Well, I told you it would. I'm glad to see you so at ease. You've grown to enjoy Crowley's presence ever since. Lately, you start to enjoy his occasional presence. He doesn't intrude, but often appears with a casual demeanor, as if he's just hanging out. Maybe you're even getting used to him just floating, gliding around as he moves. It's not as creepy as you first thought. As you chop down the vegetables in your hand, you glance over at Crowley, who has now moved to stand a little further away from the counter. He's watching you cook with a curious expression. I thought you were going to have another frozen food. Good to see you eating something healthy. You hear Crowley's voice behind you and you look around to spot him. A ghost doesn't get to comment on my food choices. Always saying that you're a ghost thing. Can't come up with a better comeback. I studied to become a doctor back then. Okay, so he was a doctor. You pause for a moment and look at him. Oh, that's interesting. You see Crowley shifting his position, now leaning his elbow on the counter. Yeah, I'll take that as a compliment. I know what I'm talking about, so it won't just be generic eat healthy stuff. You can't help but laugh at his comment. Well then, ghost doctor, why don't you give your fellow ghost friends a medical checkup? Ha ha ha, what? That's so cheesy. You and Crowley laugh together. Maybe because of how quiet this town is, so much so that you're starting to enjoy the presence even of a ghost. I wish we could have talked like this when we were humans. You feel Crowley look at you with a hint of tenderness in his eyes behind those smugness you've never seen before. Maybe it was a typo, but he said when we were human. What happened to me? This is a save time. Definitely gonna save. Just in case I don't get to choose every option. Tell him a joke. Ask him. Let's start with the top. Ask him if he wants to be human again. Do you ever wish you could be human again? To feel what it's like to live without being a ghost? Crowley's expression softens slightly, though a flicker of sadness crosses his face. Sometimes, maybe. It felt like a strange feeling being trapped between worlds. Remember bits and pieces of what it was like to be alive, but I can't go back. I used to dwell on it, I guess. But recently I don't think it is the case. I see it as a chance of life again, just with more pros and cons. He looks around the room with a distant gaze. I've come to accept my place here. There are other things that matter more now. Besides, I found a different kind of purpose here. That's certainly something, huh? Not gonna lie, the way you worded it was like we knew each other back when you were still alive. Oh no, it's just, yeah, back then. I meant that as in, I missed out on a lot of things back when I was human, that's all. I studied way too much and I tried to meet unrealistic expectations I've set for myself. Look where that got me. He shrugs dismissively, his smug smile seeming out of place amidst the heaviness of his words. No need to get emotional. I'm not feeling it anymore. Besides, being dead, being a ghost is good in its own way. You nod and let out a quick chuckle, shaking your head at his mischievousness. Well, enough ghost talk. I want to eat my meal now. You want me to read you a story over it? No, Crowley, I don't want you to read a story over my meal. I'm good.
No, thank you.
You laugh as you pick up your plate and carry it over to the living room while Crowley follows you behind. Dining together with him has become a frequent thing. Crowley's presence is once unsettling, but now has become oddly comforting, now in the quietness of your new home. Even if you're still not entirely sure of his intentions. He may have a sharp tongue, but there's a certain kindness about him. Is that an ending? Okay, I thought it was ending. I'm sorry. You sit on the edge of the bed with your knees pulled up to your chest. Your phone feels heavy in your hand as you mindlessly scroll through the short videos, not really paying attention to any of them. You can feel Crowley's presence in the room, even if you can't see his figure. You just know he's always nearby, gazing at you. Hey, it's about time you get used to my presence. You know I've been there the whole time, so how about a little hi to recognize my presence? Just greet me and I'll come close. His voice is soft and teasing as usual as he hovers near your bed. Especially after I helped you get rid of the troublesome poltergeist, I think it's about time that you get used to me. I wouldn't call it fear, Crowley. It's just not every day you wake up to realize you can see a ghost, let alone talk to one. You can't expect me to just get used to it. You glance over him, still not entirely sure how to process his presence. He looks so real, but he isn't. You think I'm some kind of nightmare, huh? More like something from a dream I never expected to have. You don't have to worry. I'm not here to hurt you. This place is mine too. Always has been. Think of it like we're just sharing a space now. And that you have a roommate. And that you have a roommate that just happens to be a ghost. That's simple. His words are oddly comforting that you can't help but let out a laugh. Not that simple. Crowley nods, and for once you see him being sincere. No more sly grin. Take all the time you need to get used to me. I'm never going anywhere. You always feel Crowley's presence before you can see him. You've been staring at that little screen for hours now. Isn't there something more productive you could be doing? You don't have the right to comment on how I waste my time. Crowley chuckles and leans in towards your phone. Shut it. You're staying here so I'm allowed to. He hovers so close that he's about to touch your screen, but his fingers phase through it. You feel his fingers brush against your thumb. It's an odd sensation that's cold and fleeting. Short videos popular now, seems. You pull back slightly, his gaze trailing over the screen before returning to your face. Didn't you mention to your boyfriend the other day that you wanted to study more often? You notice a subtle bitterness in the way he says boyfriend. Study what? Whatever you wanted. Isn't your boyfriend on the way to becoming a doctor? He does not like him, and I don't know why, but her boyfriend is a doctor, so maybe they got some kind of history there. You don't want to get left behind, do you? He floats in the chair opposite of you and crosses one leg over the other with his head tilted slightly. I once wanted to become a doctor too. You notice the change in his tone when he said that. But, well, life fell out, and here I am, I guess. Crowley quickly stands, his snarking tone returning as he waves off seriousness of the moment. But you still feel something heavy, the bitterness of his earlier words lingering. If you were still alive, maybe you with my boyfriend? Let's do that. Maybe it'll open up something and we can get like a reason why he dislikes our boyfriend so much. Crowley freezes and you see his eyes widen. Oh, a hard worker, huh? Crowley's voice is low, almost as if he's talking more to himself than you. Do you even know what that means? Hard workers? They pay for good grades, buy their way into prestigious colleges, study abroad, nothing genuine. Just cash and connections. Yeah, I bet that's what kind of hard worker your boyfriend is. You raise your brow at his words, feeling a sense of deep-seated contempt in his voice.
Whoa. Let me scoot up a little bit. Let me get comfortable and relax a little bit into this.
What are you saying, Crowley? I said what I said. Those so-called hard workers, they don't actually do the work. They just pay for the appearance of it.
Okay. What he's saying is true, though.
It's easy to hide behind a facade of due diligence when you've got the means to manipulate the system. You feel there's a personal frustration in his words, a deeper resentment that he's barely concealing. He runs his hand through his ghostly hair, then looks at you again with a forced grin. But sure, maybe we could have studied together. Maybe we'd be best buds. You still feel like you struck a nerve, even if Crowley is acting like it doesn't matter. Sorry, I probably just have a biased view on them. I shouldn't care about it so much now, because now I'm just a dead guy with nowhere to go.
You got a point.
He sighs, fiddling with the noose like a toy while glancing at you as if waiting for a reaction. But hey, being a ghost isn't so bad now. He grins, fiddling with the noose like a toy.
It went backwards? Hello? Oh, okay. He's still fiddling with it. Okay. I'm sorry. My bad. That was my bad.
Isn't so bad, you say?
Mm-hmm.
Crowley's smirk widens at your words and he leans back, looking at you. Because I still have something to care about. Something I'm confident in getting now. Very recently, that is. He gives a dismissive wave of his hand, finally letting go of the noose and shoving his hand into one of his pockets. You know, like what they say about the wandering ghosts. There's a reason they're still here in this world. Why would they linger in a world where they don't belong? People can't hardly see me. And I am no expectation either. Well, I guess everyone's got their own little delusion to keep going, it seems. Even ghost. You see Crowley shake his head at your words. No, I wouldn't call it delusions myself. I'm a ghost, but my thoughts are real. Want to know more what kind of thoughts I have as a ghost?
Oh no, I think I'm good for now.
All right, if you say so. You know the offer will always be there. I like being interviewed. I take pride in being a ghost, sort of.
Okay.
You roll your eyes at his words, shaking your head with a little bit of amusement. The offer is tempting, but you also haven't been able to talk to Abel today. Okay, give me some space now. I need to get some sleep.
Crowley raises an eyebrow at your words and speaks in a teasing tone.
Lies. It's more like, I need some space to talk with my boyfriend.
You click your tongue, acknowledging his point with a resigned sigh.
Ugh, yeah, you got me. All right, I'll leave you to it then. Have fun when he's around.
I wonder if he'd be watching us when we get nasty. He probably does.
You watch as Crowley waves his hand and fades from the view. The room always feels lighter yet emptier without his presence. You pull out your laptop and initiate a video call with Abel. He had promised to call you more often, but seems a few days since the last time you two even talked on the phone. He could call you after work. I don't know why he doesn't. He always seems so busy with his internship thing. After a moment, the screen finally lights up and reveals Abel's face. "Hey there, darling. I'm so happy you called. You know I've been thinking about you all day. Sorry I haven't been able to call you today. It was so hectic. Today was fantastic at the hospital. Was it now?" "Oh, you wouldn't believe all the things that I got to do." You see, Abel's excitement is palpable. Like how it's always been. His voice is full of energy and pride.
"I don't know what it is, but I'm getting an uneasy feeling about Crowley and,
Abel. They probably don't like each other. They really don't like each other. They don't know each other, and they don't like each other. So listen, I was in the OR for most of the day. We had this incredible surgery, appendectomy, but the patient has some really unusual complications. I got to assess with the procedure and watch the whole thing. It was intense, but so rewarding. The way the surgeon navigated through those complications was just... Try to focus on the things that he was telling you, but you feel like your mind is elsewhere now. It was just so cool, you know?" His voice snaps you back into the presence. "Oh, yes, it's really an amazing opportunity for you, love. So happy you decided to take this internship offer. Your focus keeps drifting." "Oh, it really is. Well, listen now. It was..." He continues without skipping a beat while you nod along. It's sometimes men just don't see that you're not paying attention. Your mind drifts again at his voice, reflecting on the distance that seems to grow with every conversation. "Anyway, how was my favorite person? I hope your day was good too." The question seems almost secondary, much like an obligation to his end. You always tell yourself about how genuine his affection is. Yet, he doesn't even seem to remember making time for you. "Oh, just the usual, busy day at work, but nothing too exciting." "I'm glad to hear that you're doing well." "I know, I've been so busy, but I just get so excited after all of this. But, sorry, I want to go ahead and rest now." His smile is warm and his tone is loving, but the call ends feels somewhat abrupt. Again, you can always tell if somebody likes you or not. "I can't wait to see you. I'll try to call you more from now. Okay? Take care."
"Take care too, Abel."
They didn't even say "I love you." That's crazy. I always tell Song I love him. Never. I would never end a call like that. And if I didn't, I would at least text it. The call ends and Abel's image fades in your screen. This is not the first time he doesn't live up to his words. You shouldn't be surprised anymore. He's always so affectionate with you, but it feels hollow. You turn your laptop away and decide to knock yourself to sleep. With a sigh, you turn off the lights before settling into bed. Sleepy time. The next day arrives, and with it, you start your work from home job. It's boring and tedious, but the pay is enough to make it worthwhile. At least you spared the long commutes and early mornings. It makes you think about Abel, your boyfriend's internship. He's always talking about the grind, those long commutes, 8 hours on his feet, constantly learning, constantly pushing forward. Off to a bright future, just like his father always wanted. Everything seems to fall into place for him. He's driven, focused, sure of his path. Born with a silver spoon in his mouth. And yet, Abel. Whenever you start doubting his affection towards you, you always remind yourself how admirable he is. Smart, ambitious, loving. Handsome too, with a well-off family. He's got it all. You couldn't ask for a better partner. And yet, being around him only seems to pull you down. You feel like a spectator in his life, with how wrapped up he is in his own world he seems to be. I mean, that's bad. That's really bad. That's a we need to have a talk type of relationship. You sigh, staring at your screen, but the numbers and words blur. You're not focusing at all. Hey,
Oh, hi, Crowley. When you look up, he's already here, watching you with the same expression. He's leaning casually against the wall like he's been here the whole time. Crowley's here again. But weirdly enough, you didn't even feel his presence this time, see? I'm telling you, he's got a way to hide his presence. You don't want him to be here. Not in this moment. Worst timing ever. Crowley, I didn't hear you come in. Of course you wouldn't. You were lost in thought, and I'm a ghost. I don't need doors. He hovers a little closer to you. Thinking about your boyfriend again, huh? You blink, taken aback by how easily he reads you. I heard last night's conversation you had with your boyfriend. See, he can hear our stuff. Abel, right? An inspiring doctor, your boyfriend. He's not giving you a chance to finish your words. He's the whole package. Smart, handsome, wealthy. People like to say that about guys like him, don't they? You don't respond, but the discomfort grows. Deep down, you know that's not the case. What do you mean? Oh, you know it better than anyone else. You know exactly what I meant. Crowley leans in slightly towards you with a bitter smirk. For someone who has it all, he can't even meet your most basic needs. Despite his sarcasm, you find it hard to argue. But hey, he's busy, right? Always too busy for you. Because he's always got time for his friends, his job, future, but no when it comes to your needs. You're just there to entertain him when he's got no one else to be with. Ouch. So many relationships I had felt just like that. You were never his priority. It's all just pretty words to distract you from the lack of genuine effort. Crowley keeps going on, tilting his head to the side as he studies the changes in your expression. Oh my god, with a disdainful grin on his face. You're not sure if it's directed at you or at Abel. You ever wonder if Abel really respects you, or are you just another check on his list of things to make him look perfect? Maybe it's time you stop pretending he's the whole package, huh? You open your mouth to argue, but the words die in your throat. Crowley isn't wrong, and the truth stings more than you want to admit. He doesn't care enough about you. It's crystal clear. Believe his actions, not his words.
Ooh, Crowley, he's speaking that truth. I see you.
There's something unnerving about how accurate Crowley is. Like, he's been observing the cracks in our relationship this whole time. Maybe he has.
You're wrong. He tries. He's just busy.
Yeah, too busy. Busy enough to make you doubt if you still mean anything to him at all. It is the damned bottom of the barrel. You flinch at the venom laced in his words. Man, what a wimp. These are the things you've always felt but never dared to say out loud. And here Crowley is, laying it all bare. You deserve someone who actually sees you. You're not some kind of trophy in his perfect little life. Funny thing is, even a trophy gets put on display. You're just an afterthought.
Ooh, my God. Relax, Crowley. Take it back a bit.
Despite the way he delivers the message, you can feel that it comes out of a place of concern. Crowley hovers away and gives you a casual shrug, like the heavy words he just said don't even matter. Anyway, I said more than I should. I can't be bothering you when you're busy at work.
Then why did you say so much?
Your heavy energy is really impacting my mood, especially since I'm a ghost hunting this place. Being a ghost makes me sensitive to energies. And, well, I don't want to see you wasting your time on that boyfriend of yours. His words still hurt, but you know it's just harsh truth at this point. He reaches out, giving your shoulder a pat, but
His hand passes right through your body as expected. Just cold air where his touch should be.
Wait, Crowley?
Before you can respond, he's already gone, fading into the air without a sound. I mean, Crowley is right. He does not care about us. And he's been proven that time after time, he's saying, yes, I promise to be there for you and all this other stuff. And the one time he was, like, actually there for us was when we moved in with him. You stand there for a moment, lingering in the strange mix of comfort and confusion he's left behind. His words replay in your head even as the room falls silent. You turn towards the couch and sink into it, your mind swirling with thoughts of Crowley's unsettling truth. Oddly, you do feel comforted. Maybe because for the first time in a long while, someone really understood you. The day drags on, your work from home tasks growing more tedious by the minute. You nod and thank your higher ups before ending the call and stretching your back and putting the laptop aside. You feel drained. No, that would be an understatement. You've been exhausted, both from the job and from your spiraling thoughts. You keep thinking back about Crowley's words and the reality of your relationship with Abel. Forgive me, you guys. I've been reading for a while, so I'm losing my voice a little bit, and I don't have any more water. It hasn't left your mind ever since. You decide to make your way to the kitchen, hoping to make your favorite drink and wind down after the day. As you stir the liquids in the cup, your mind wanders back to Crowley's words. His sharp, cutting remarks about Abel, the ones you haven't been able to shake off. The worst part is, he wasn't wrong. You stir your drink more forcefully, trying to focus on anything else as it makes harsher clinking noise. It's crazy to let him get under your skin like that. A ghost of all things. You shouldn't be thinking this much. But then again, Abel's behavior. Your thoughts trail off, interrupted by a sudden buzzing of your phone on the counter. You turn around to reach your phone and see who the caller is. Abel's name flashes on the screen. Maybe he's going to prove to us that he can actually step up to the plate and be a good boyfriend. You contemplate whether to pick up the call or no, and you hear a familiar giggle. Not going to pick it up? Crowley, you're here again? He's already there, hovering by the counter with his pair of green eyes that stare at you intently. You click your tongue as you glance down at your phone again. Abel's calling, but Crowley's words echo louder in your mind now. Come on, aren't you curious what he wants this time? Crowley tilts his head as he asks. He's daring you to test what you already know. The ringing feels almost obnoxious now, and Crowley's presence makes the decision harder. Or you should just let it go to voicemail. As much as he says he misses you. You narrow your eyes at him. Give him a taste of his own medicine. Just this once. Your phone stops ringing, silence filling the room once more. There it is. Crowley chuckles softly and drifts back with a smug expression. Oh man. This was his plan the whole time, is to pull me away from Abel. But Abel is not a good boyfriend. To keep making promises and breaking them. You may not be out there cheating or anything like that, but neglecting your girlfriend is still a bad thing. You want to brush him off, but the truth is, you've been feeling it too. His voice gets under your skin like a splinter. It's so frustrating. You feel like crying just letting all of this finally sink in. Crowley's influence shouldn't be this strong, but you can't help it. A part of you wants to cling to how much he seems to understand you, like he's peering into your mind, you know? It's not crazy to want more, to want someone who actually cares about you. I mean, that's what a boyfriend should be doing in the first place. You glare at him, but you barely have the energy to argue because you know he's just speaking the truth of your feelings. Don't torture yourself for much longer. You're still alive, come on. Even the dead knows, oh my god, I just had a bad thought. Is he trying to get her to schmill herself? Like, nobody cares about you, your boyfriend doesn't care about you, and he's all you got. Oh man, I hope that's not what he's trying to do. Even the dead knows to make better decisions than you. Compared to the last time, you feel that Crowley's words feel less like mockery and more like concern. Your phone buzzes again. This time, a text from Abel, asking why you didn't pick up. Oh, look at that. I guess it's actually important to him now. Or did ignoring his call just bruise his ego? He's trying to get Abel to come over there, right? Or he's trying to... I am saving all of these because I might go back and do some of them. Either he's trying to get Abel to come over there, or he's trying his hardest to get us to schmill ourselves. Those are my two decisions. Pick up the phone and answer a text. Leave the phone and confront Crowley. Put the phone on silent and sit with Crowley. Maybe this might be an ending. Let's put the phone down. Put it on silent and sit with Crowley. You turn your phone on silent, setting it aside, and take a seat at the table. Crowley follows you, almost pleased. Guess you're not in the mood for empty conversations tonight, huh? He hovers near you, his presence almost comforting in a strange way. It's unsettling how much easier it feels to sit with a ghost than to deal with your boyfriend. Hush, phone. Stop interrupting me. What's wrong? Still struggling to find the right words? Crowley's voice turns softer. His eyes study you with a mixture of amusement and something like concern. Why don't you just take it slow for a bit? Give yourself a break. Abel's not going anywhere. The situation isn't going anywhere. Relax for a moment and allow yourself to think clearly. Decide if this is what you want. Deep down, you realize how bizarre it is to feel comforted by a ghost. You should be seeking understanding from a living person, not from someone who's no longer part of this world. But here you are, finding solace in a spectral being. Well, yay, I guess. Sometimes all you need is a little break to sort things out. Don't be so hard on yourself. You nod slowly, finally letting yourself give in. I've got to go for now, but remember, taking care of yourself is the most important thing. You've been through a lot mentally. I'll make sure you get that break. Oh man, Crowley's voice softens and he begins to drift away. You watch him go and his presence weakens, then gone, now left alone with your thoughts again. Is this the next morning? In the days that follow, you start to take Crowley's advice seriously. You still reply to Abel's messages, still talking to Abel, but your heart isn't consumed by the constant worry and overthinking. You respond when it feels right, but the conversations aren't the center of your world anymore. Crowley told you, stop giving it the only power it has, your attention. Hey. Oh, Crowley. Crowley is around more often now. Always around the corner. His presence used to be scary, but now it feels just like a friend to you. This evening, you find yourself curled up on the living room couch watching a movie. You haven't been talking with Abel as often, but it doesn't bother you like it used to. You pop a popcorn into your mouth with Crowley floating on the sofa. I mean, you could hand him one. No? Okay. This is the kind of show you like? What? Judging me again? No, I like you too. For the briefest moment, you catch a faint blush on his cheeks, but you brush it off as if a trick of the dim lighting. At least they're liking each other's presence. It's hard to imagine a ghost blushing. You see Crowley pick up popcorn as well and shove it into his mouth, munching on it. Ghosts can eat too? Of course not.
I don't eat as much as I still want to enjoy these human treats. He grins smugly, leaning back against the couch, although his head passes through it a little. If you could still eat, what would you like to have right now?
Good question. I'd say cookies, chocolate chip cookies.
Didn't take you for a sweet tooth type. Crowley rolls his eyes and shrugs.
Everyone said that back when I was a human too.
I know. I'm too rigid. You raise your brow at his words.
Is that how you were described when you were alive? It's because I was just never myself back when I was alive. That's why I said being a ghost is like a second chance to live. I was too worried about other people's judgments, too lenient, too much of a yes man back when I was a human. Too naive for believing all of that would lead me to a good place. But see where that got me.
Your eyes drift to the noose around his neck, the grim reminder of how he left this world. A part of you want to ask, but you swallow your question. The story's written plainly enough in the details. It already speaks for itself.
So which one's the real you?
Don't know. Isn't the answer obvious? Crowley smirks and reaches his hand out towards you, but you avoid him.
It's weird when you try to touch me. Your hand just kind of goes through everything. It feels eerie.
Crowley blinks and laughs, shaking his head as he retracts his hand back.
You're always such a riot.
He ends the laugh with a sigh and falls silent, watching the TV show again. The TV show, a movie about paranormal activities in the house, with ghosts bothering the homeowners. The eerie scenes and ghostly apparitions on the screen remind you of the spirit Crowley had helped you get rid of. You turn to look at Crowley, who is sitting beside you. He's still silent, watching the movie with an unreadable expression.
Hey, Crowley?
I've been wondering, what do ghosts really do? I mean, in movies like this, they can do some pretty crazy stuff. Can you? Crowley glances at you for a moment, then turns back to the screen.
Depends on the ghost. Not all of us can do the stuff you see in movies. Me, though? I can do some things, but it's mostly just floating around, watching things. You know, the usual ghost stuff.
Usual ghost stuff, you say?
Yeah. Don't believe in those silly horror movies. Ghosts like me doesn't have any crazy abilities like how they portray us to be.
You know what's funny? I think about it like 50 years from now. What are we going to tell our, like, oh, I had a ghost friend named Crowley.
Okay, I see.
His response feels oddly vague, but you accept it without question and just laugh. The movie continues and you laugh along with Crowley at the particularly funny scenes. It feels good to share a moment like this with him. After a while, you start to feel hungry. You were just eating popcorn. How are you hungry? Glancing at the clock, you think it's time for a snack. But something feels off. The time hasn't moved at all.
Why is the time...
What's wrong with the time?
Nothing's wrong.
You feel that he might be hiding something.
No, Crowley.
You must have done something.
Why would you accuse me like that? I literally just told you earlier that ghosts like me can't do any crazy things like in the movies. Manipulating the clock? Nah. I'm just your friendly neighborhood ghost. Now I don't believe you, Crowley, at all.
Remember, I told... Y'all keep in mind, I want y'all to keep thinking because y'all smart too. He did say we in that one statement that kind of indicated like we're both dead.
Oh, man.
You're not sure how you can word what you want to say.
Then why are you looking away?
What?
You're not being honest. You're looking away from me when you talk. I've noticed this habit from you.
I don't know. I just feel like you would look away and say certain things sometimes. I mean, you wouldn't do that without a reason, right? Did it skip something? It didn't. Okay. Huh. So you're not as stupid as your boyfriend like I thought. I see. Took you long enough to notice, huh? You turn around, startled to find Crowley's face only mere inches from yours. Don't panic. It definitely did. What do you mean? Don't tell me. You were. It was all going so well. I was convinced that it would stay this way. I was so close to trapping you in my realm forever. His usual mischievousness is replaced by something darker, more unsettling. Why are you upset? You've been avoiding the truth for ages. Surely you wouldn't mind this. What the hell are you talking about? This isn't a game. The air shifts, becoming almost suffocating. Oh, you think I'm playing games? This isn't a game. It never has been. I've always been dead serious. You called me too rigid when I was alive.
You?
I told you I'd give you time to relax. Nothing's going anywhere.
The music is speeding up and I'm getting worried.
I've been making that happen.
I'm so scared. Sorry, I had to stop for a second and the music has stopped and then I got scared because the music was completely like, it was just going like, for a long, long time and it scared me. Okay, whew.
You can no longer see where Crowley is, but you still feel his presence really strongly around you. I'm not letting him walk all over you again. And you need someone to help you see that. That doesn't give you the right to mess with me like this. Has being with Abel made you so oblivious that you can't grasp something so simple? What a waste. I'm trying to help you, and you're too blind to see it. Sometimes, talking isn't enough. It takes a shove. Maybe that's exactly what you need. You attempt to back away, but your legs feel like lead. Crowley's presence envelops you. You feel like an oppressive force wrapping around you like a vice. Stop! Your voice falters as his presence suffocates you. Are we dead now? He killed us. Okay. When you come to, you're lying on the couch. First thing you notice is Abel's voice. Hey, babe. Oh, God, are you okay? I just got here moments ago. You blink, trying to make sense of what just happened. Your head pounds. As you sit up, you realize something's missing. Crowley's presence. The ghostly presence you become familiar with. It's gone. Huh? What happened? Abel looks at you with worrying etched on his face. You passed out, like, right after I got here. Oh no, is Crowley in me now? I mean, I don't even know how long it's been. I'm just glad you're awake now. I was just about to take you to the hospital. Despite Abel's presence, you can't shake the unsettling feeling gnawing at you. The absence of Crowley leaves you an eerie emptiness.
Oh God, I hope he's not inside of me.
But it's hard to think straight when you're still trying to process what just happened. You remember how angry Crowley seemed to be earlier. You're not sure what he meant by trapping you in this realm forever. You should be glad that he's gone, but you still feel very uneasy.
Baby, are you okay?
You reach for Abel's face, your fingers brushing his cheek as if to ground yourself. You smile gently, but there's something in your heart that feels off. Hey, I'm okay, baby. Calm down. I'm more worried about you. You look pale. What happened? Are you sick? He wraps his arms around you, pulling you into a soothing embrace. His touch is warm, but it doesn't comfort you like it used to. There's a sense of heaviness in your chest that seems to grow when he's near. You feel a combination of anger and disgust towards him. Sorry I haven't had time to see you again. You know how it goes. But finally managed to spare time today. I'm sure you'll forgive me, right? He pulls back and offers you a smile, but you can't return it. Even as he tries to reassure you, the disconnect between the two of you feels stronger than ever. You start remembering Crowley's words. You want to be happy, but he's here. But his affectionate tone only drags you down. Something about him makes you feel more repulsed. What's been going on? You seem a bit off lately. I noticed it, you know. Your texts are less frequent, and they feel more curt. Plus, you've been spacing out during our conversations. It breaks my heart. So tell me, is something bothering you?
You feel worse knowing he's right. So just tell him, please, please tell him.
You've been distant, preoccupied, but there's no way you can explain why. Not without telling him about Crowley. You need to tell him about Crowley now, even if he's not here anymore.
Abel, I...
Yes? You pause, but something inside of you pushes forward. I want to break up. The words spill from your lips, shocked both you and Abel. His eyes widen in disbelief, and your heart races. Wait, what? Your hand flies to your mouth, and you feel panic rising in your chest. I didn't mean to say that. I didn't mean it. I cheated on you.
Oh my god. Oh, Crowley, you monster.
You didn't mean to say those words, but when you try to explain, something else comes out. You cheated? You grip your lips, feeling as though something else is controlling your voice.
Huh? No, I didn't mean that. Abel,
you want to tell him about your experience with the ghost named Crowley. I said I want to break up. But you can't stop. You keep saying you want to break up with him instead. Darling, tell me, what do you mean you cheated? You try to fight it, but it's like your own body has turned against you.
It means exactly just that. I'm sick of this. Sick of how one-sided everything feels. You never listen.
What are you talking about? I'm here now. I'm trying my best to make you happy, babe.
That's what you would always say to me. But you just say a lot of things. You don't follow through. And I've gotten sick of it. Of you and your excuses. Of being here. Of playing the role as your partner. That's why I cheated on you.
What? What are you talking about? Who?
Crowley. I cheated with Crowley.
Crowley? What?
Crowley Lenore. You know him, don't you?
You're screaming inside. You feel your thoughts racing in pure panic. You don't understand why you can't stop talking.
Where is he?
Isn't he?
Doesn't matter. You're too reckless to guarantee he's dead and buried. Crowley's leagues ahead of you.
Oh, no.
You're way too self-centered to be cautious, especially with all the safety nets you have, aren't you?
Abel's face goes pale. Jesus. Tell me you didn't do anything bad, Abel.
He steps closer and extends his hand in a weak attempt to soothe you.
Baby, you're not making sense right now. Please calm down.
You see an edge of panic lurking beneath the surface of gentleness.
Crowley couldn't just sit by after you ruined his life. He couldn't let you win.
Crowley? What are you talking about? I didn't kill him. I didn't even know someone named Crowley.
You're just saying things, babe.
Are you crazy? I never killed anyone. I'm not capable of that, please.
All I've been doing is just studying, babe.
You don't know who to believe. Oh my god.
Crowley's influence makes you want to take his side and echo his words to Abel. But then there's Abel's face with his desperate look as he responds to the accusations. You can't figure out what's real anymore.
Come on, babe. You're saying weird things. Are you having an episode again?
Let's talk, okay? Let's just figure this out. Just calm down. Abel reaches out to you again and tries to pull you into a hug. Stop grabbing her, please, and just listen. Let him spew this out. Maybe if he gets out of his system, he won't feel so bad. But you slap his hand away.
Keep your hands off me, murderer.
Okay. What? I'm not a murderer.
A cowardly murderer who's too afraid to get his own hands dirty. Yes, I'm talking about you, Abel. Your lips are your weapon. Your wealth is a shield. Your influence. All of that drove me to my freaking death.
The raw anger in your voice is not your own. It's Crowley's. Abel stumbles back in shock and disbelief flashes across his face when you pick up a knife.
Wait. What are you doing?
Oh no, I didn't want to do this.
He's not the confident, happy figure you've known. He's just scared. He thinks that you're going to kill him. Your mind is split in two. On one side, you're screaming at yourself to stop and get a hold of yourself. Yet on the other side, you hear Crowley's voice moving your body.
Admit what you did to Crowley. Admit what you did.
How do you even know all of this? You weren't there.
About Crowley.
Yeah.
Oh man, he did something bad to Crowley.
To say, like, how would you even know this? You weren't there?
Oh man, say it ain't so, Abel. I always thought you were the less hotter one anyway.
He would have had a good life. If only you hadn't done what you did, none of this would have happened. You stole everything from Crowley. His scores, his chance, his future.
That internship was never yours, Abel.
My career, my life, it was all lined up and you took it because you couldn't handle seeing me succeed.
No, I didn't. It wasn't like that, I swear.
You don't know what you're saying. Please stop this.
Please, baby, this isn't you. Whatever this is, we can fix it. We can talk. Just put the knife down.
This isn't you. It really isn't me.
He's pathetic, isn't he? Always running his mouth. It's freaking sickening and lazy. Abel's words are now drowned out by the chilling voice whispering inside you.
Crowley, stop this. I don't want to do this. I don't want to hurt him.
Uh-oh.
Oh, darling.
Not you too.
I could never have anything when I was alive.
Ever. Don't stop me. This wimp right here ruined it all for me. I worked so hard. So freaking hard. He ran over me and took everything.
Your feet move closer and Abel crawls back at the same time. Please, don't do this. I'm sorry for whatever it is. Just tell me. Tell me what's going on.
My vision is fading, so I'm worried that something bad's gonna happen because, as you can see, can't see nothing.
But the grip tightens on the knife. His words doesn't reach you anymore. All that fills your mind is the overwhelming need to silence him.
Still wouldn't admit it, even though you're going to die, huh?
Crowley's overwhelming need in your body to kill Abel. He deserves this. He always takes everything from you, too.
So are we getting the same ending? Is this not the same ending we got in the last one?
Your time, your life, your love. It's time you took something back. We're similar in a way.
You stop just right in front of Abel. He looks at you with wide, terrifying eyes, begging for his life. But your body moves as the blade gleaming under the dim light.
Oh no. No, please.
No. Dang it.
Oh man.
What have I done? This isn't happening.
You see Abel's lifeless body on the ground, bleeding from his chest with his mouth agape.
Thank you for blurring it out. I appreciate it.
Blood pools around him.
That's not me blurring it out, that's the game.
Bright red seeping into the floor, staining everything in its path. Ah, much better. You hear Crowley's voice echo in your head, rich with satisfaction. You stand frozen and stare at the reality of what you've done. You killed Abel.
No. No, this isn't me. I didn't want this.
Oh, but you did. You've always wanted him gone, haven't you? Now it's done. You're free. You feel your chest heave and tears well up in your eyes, but Crowley's laughter fills your mind.
I killed him. I killed him.
I did, silly. I did. Don't take the credit away from me. I've always wanted my revenge. The blood isn't on you. It's on me.
Abel's terrified eyes is burned into your mind. The sight of him. God. He just looks so scared. You know, it will never go away.
Oh, turning his precious darling against him right in front of his face? Priceless. Honestly, I couldn't have planned it better if I tried. Sure, I'm dead, but I've got everything I wanted. So who's really winning here?
Oh, Crowley, huh? Look at the pictures. The pictures make you worse.
Now I just need a body. You don't want me stuck in your head forever, right?
No.
But let's be real. It's so much easier to control you from here. Even if death comes knocking one day, you'll just become a ghost and stay with me forever. You'll have nothing left except me right here in your head.
Ending 2 of 3, forever with you. Being dead is a blessing after all. I'm gonna go check and see how many endings it is, and then I'll let you know if I'm ending it right here. So, I've gotten every ending, and with that being said, thank you so much. I'm losing my voice, as y'all can hear. I'm gonna go relax, rest, and if you want to check out this game, all the information will be in the description box below. Don't forget, if you made it this far, to like, comment, and subscribe. I will see all you guys in the next episode. Peace and love. Stay safe out there, everybody. Bye.